Warning. Please be aware that the Dub Talk podcast may contain language and content that may not be suitable for younger audiences. Viewer discretion is advised. Also be aware that this episode will contain spoilers for the entirety of Sorted Online alternative, Grimgar Online, and may contain spoilers for other series, so please be careful if you haven't finished them. And finally, please be aware that the views and opinions expressed by the participants of this episode do not reflect those of the Dub Talk podcast as a whole. Enjoy the show. Hello and welcome to Dub Talk, where a group of gamers come together to dual wield, hunt down a rogues gallery of sex offenders, and release 2 years worth of body fluids. I'm Jet, and I'm joined tonight by Roots.
Wait, Megan? Wait, are we doing what I think we're doing?
Maybe? Megan?
I got the fairy wings on. Bring on the tentacles.
And Andrew?
Hey! I bought some new untested, nerve gear equipment, I think that's what they call.
Andrew, no!
I heard really...
Do it, coward!
I heard really good interview... I heard really good reviews about this product. Nothing is gonna go wrong if I plug myself in. And I can't move my body. And I'm told this really cool game that comes with it is going to be very safe, and it's tested, and nothing could possibly go wrong.
Andrew, no!
Don't worry, Andrew. It's been beta tested. And don't worry, I'm pretty sure while you're in there, Steph will remember to cup the balls.
Yeah, that's right, folks. You've been hounding us to cover this for years. I've got 6 packs worth of booze behind me to make it through this. So I'm happy to say we're going to finally cover Sword Art Online. Now, if you haven't seen Sword Art Online, the premise goes as follows. I just got a text from our legal team.
We have a legal team?
We have a legal team?
Okay, so according to the text I got, it seems like apparently Kirito's being sued by all the exes from his harem for some back payments and alimony. Seems like the show producers are going after him for multiple unscheduled appearances in games outside SAO. And backing out of the whole if you die in a game, you die in real life policy in his contract. And the damages look to be pretty extensive, and I'm told Asuna is finally filing for a divorce. So in light of this messy situation, we have to put this episode
on. Holy shit.
Damn!
Holy shit! No. Damn, Kirito!
You live like this?
I saw it coming, but I also didn't see it coming.
I don't think any of the girls in his harem saw it coming, because it sounds like he has some shitty pullout games.
I mean, to be fair, it does take him 2 years to get them off.
So in light of
that joke has layers.
Yes, it does. So in light of this messy situation, I've been told we're to put this episode on hold effective immediately, and we're going to cover something a little safer.
Wait, what do you mean safer? Our legal team has literally put guns to our head. How is this a safer alternative?
There's a lawyer under my desk with a Luger.
Funny you mention that, so let's start this over. Hello and welcome to Dub Talk, where a group of gamers, teabag campers, prance around FPS games with pink avatars, and occasionally talk about English subs for anime. My name is Jet, and I'm joined tonight by Roots.
Teabag!
Megan?
Press F to pay respect to these nuts!
And Andrew.
I don't know what everybody's going on about. Rocket launchers and dual-wield akimbos is a fair and balanced strategy.
And we're here tonight to talk about Sword Art Online Alternative, Grimgar Online.
We are not talking about the Kirito, that's...
And you never thought there was a gun girl online.
Oh,
don't worry, the girls on this net are gay.
So if you haven't seen Gun Gale, the description from ANN, Karen Kahiribaki is a 183 centimeter tall college student.
Excuse me, I'm a filthy American. You better put that into our fucking measurement system. Thank you.
Okay.
Hang on. What was the measurement?
183 centimeters, but if you want to be American, it's 6 feet.
Yo, I'd fucking climb that.
You'd have to climb that, Andrew.
Oh,
and
fuck.
So,
you know, I know you're trying to hurt me, but you're right.
Lord have mercy.
Okay. So she enters the world of Gun Gale Online with her avatar Len, who is less than 5 feet tall and wears all pink. She meets a beautiful brown-skinned female player who goes by the name Pita Hui. They hit it off, but one day Pita Hui presses her to participate in Squad Jam, a team battle royale, and hijinks ensue. That's basically the premise.
To highlight, Team Deathmatch!
Team Deathmatch!
Stop with the team deathmatch!
Yeah. So I suppose I should preface this by saying this is technically my birthday episode. So and I was originally planning on doing something classy, but that's no fun. So we're here to talk about this kind of SAO because
team
why not?
Grimgar is entering the squad jam. We are giving you exactly what you expect from Team Grimgar, okay? Okay.
So, when does Andrew start dual-wielding pink dildos? Jet, you said you didn't want something classy, and I'm here. What did you expect?
Okay, you know what? You get that for today.
Yay!
Imagine, like, a grenade launcher, but with, like, explosive dildos.
They shoot.
You joke, but someone has almost certainly made that.
I mean,
Andrew, they literally did that for one of the Jackass movies.
Wait, actually?
Kind of.
To be fair,
put a bottle rocket on a dildo on a string that was supposed to go into a guy's ass.
I was about to ask if it went in. Okay.
No, it most certainly did not.
I wonder if when Kirito went into GGO, he was just afraid that his grenade launcher wasn't going to work for 2 years. I'm very sorry to my friend, our good friend N1. He is going to personally kick our asses for all of our Kirito jokes.
Love you, buddy. I'll say this. Is this technically our first time actually going into anything Sword Art related on this channel? I believe it is.
Yes.
Yeah.
This series was not done by Reki Kawahara. I believe it was the Kino's Journey guy.
Yeah. He somehow managed to shove himself into an episode of this while looking like Samba Thing that just walked off the Metalocalypse set.
Oh my god, you're right. No, like, they literally, the first squad jam is sponsored by an author who's apparently a huge guntaku, and they literally like, dude, that guy must be a creep.
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, you really, I appreciate how meta you're going with this, sir. Yeah. I respect the hustle.
Yeah, this is our first time talking about Sword Art. Sorry, it's not, like, actual Sword Art, but, like, okay, look, you know what, I will make this declaration here now. If we get to 5k subscribers by the end of the year, I will personally host a Sword Art Online episode. I make this solemn vow.
Oh, me and Steph have to be on it. Me and Steph have to be on it. I'll do it too, man.
I don't know anyone else would volunteer.
Me and Steph would do it.
You know what? Look, let's not make any promises yet, but let's just say, if you would like to follow our patron at the $10 tier, you can literally tell us to watch anything within a certain proximity. So,
look. Steph and I agreed that we would do Sword Art on one day. So if we get to 5K, we can do Grimgar plus one.
Yeah, that sounds fair.
I'd have my own harem. I would be our Kirito.
This is gonna. God. Okay, this is going to be an interesting night.
Okay. Steph is Okay, no. Steph is my Yu-Gi-Oh! Roots is definitely my Asuna. Jet, you get to be Shinon.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay.
I mean, he's...
This is already off to a... I don't even know what kind of start this is. It's not a Link start, that's for fucking sure.
Yeah, alright. Okay, I guess we should get to actually talking about this show. So, as always, we'll start off by talking about our AEO director and scriptwriter, who in this case happened to be one and the same. That one being one Alex Von David, who has... credits on some pretty heavy hitters, including Toradora, Blue Exorcist, Erased, and, of course, every season of Sword Art Online. So I'm just kind of imagining Mr. Burns with the, like, don't forget you're here forever sign, but instead of Mr. Burns, it's just Klein burned out on some weed.
Look, at this point, Alex is along for the ride, so I'm sure he's having a fun time with it.
Look, I am pretty sure at this point, Alex Von David... took that don't forget you're here forever sign, put a bunch of Klaus pictures on it, and now it just says do it for him.
Good lord.
Or Klein, I'm sorry. Not Klaus.
Klaus! I'm about to be like, who's Klaus?
Klaus is clearly Alex Von David's Sword Art Sona.
Okay. Are we now inventing his own... Are we now inventing the director, ADR director and writer's fanfic character, which... Look, I can and will.
I think we should just stick to his writing and directing stuff, which, if you don't mind, Jet, I will start off on.
Oh, sure, go ahead.
Seeing as Leafia and Asuna here are fighting over my attention, thanks, Shinon, for being my backbone. So wait, if Hardy's Silica, who gets to be Lisbeth? Amon gets... Amon's gonna be Lisbeth. Gigi gets to be Klein. And, Jamal can be my daughter, Yuki. What's her name?
Who's gonna be, oh my god, why am I blanking on his name? I just know his first name's actually Andrew, like me.
Oh, the guy who runs the bar. Zen.
Oh my god, why am I blanking on his name? Holy shit.
The guy who patched, anyway, while Andrew Googles that, I mean, I'm sorry, while Leafia Googles that, I think the running interaction in this is pretty solid. This was a weird show where, like, I don't believe we got to watch this as it simulcast in Japan, right? Was it, like, Netflix jailed or some shit?
No, this was just...
This was?
Yeah, it was simulcast.
Yes, this was a simulcast. It was on CR.
Yes, it was on Crunchyroll. I literally watched the simulcast.
Okay, my apologies. I got this I probably got this confused with Fate or some shit.
You probably did, yeah.
No, so I think the writing on this is solid. This... clearly is having a lot of fun with the writing. There are some absolute one-liners, like one girl calling somebody their sugar daddy. My personal favorite line is, if you start cursing in the game, you'll start doing it in real life. You do it on the subway. Can't you be more elegant about it? Fine. Fight me, you coward. You have no testicles.
Dude, I love that.
Just... I absolutely adore the writing on this. There's a lot of really fun little one-liners, and when it needs to be dramatic in the way that only Sword Art can be, because face it, I know there are fans of Sword Art on there, and dunking on Sword Art Online is like anime Twitter's favorite and anime YouTube's favorite activity. And to be fair, I've personally, back when I was on other channels, have been personally hard on Sword Art Online as a franchise. But in the grand scheme of isekai that have come out since, Sword Art Online is actually not that bad, and Kirito isn't as much of a ditz as we think he is. But, when Sword Art tries to be dramatic in the way that only Sword Art can, and by dramatic I mean pants on head stupid, it tries. The only issue I have is that I feel like sometimes some of the actors are very much pushing their higher ranges. And for some of them, you can tell, and it's a little kind of screechy, and it's that Moe voice that I think a lot of people who like to hate on anime dubs be like, see, they can't do the Moe voice, they're faking it, da 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 da, and you're just like, dude, you're not gonna watch the dub anyway, why are you here? That being said, I think that this is a dub that people who have never seen Sword Art, or if they just want to put something on for the day, they can easily enjoy. It's very charming. Maybe not the best of the Sword Art dub I've heard, like, especially comparing it to the main series. I think those dubs are a little bit stronger, but this was still a good time overall.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you know what, Andrew?
Yeah, no, I can kind of echo a lot of the sentiments where it's like, this... Sword Art is a franchise. It is very easy to make fun of. It's very easy to dunk on. I think my opinion in recent years has kind of let up a little bit. I don't think I hate it as much as, like, I think I remember I used to. But I will say I've also kind of gotten an appreciation for the fact that when it's kind of dumb and melodramatic, it's actually kind of fun. And while... ironically enough, my least favorite stuff in GGO is when it tries to do melodramatic. That's also kind of fun and silly in its own right, so I'm still entertained. But I think what I enjoy about the show is that the show is actually being people playing a game, and for the most part, it's like, the stakes aren't really that high, it's just kind of personal, okay, I'm a game... I'm here because I couldn't get tickets to a concert. I'm kind of pissed. I need to shoot people now. Is a very real motive. And, no, it's like, it's silly, and I actually, like, this is one of the first few times in Sword Art where it's like, people are playing a video game, and I actually believe they're having fun playing a video game together, and that's cool. I think the dialogue is pretty fun, and for the sake of this show, I will give credit where it's due. It's definitely easier for some actors than others. I'm very impressed at, like, because this show has actors that have to be in-game voice and IRL voice.
Yeah, I will praise that too, and I'm sorry I missed that, but I'll let you do that.
Fair enough. It's like, that they are two distinctly sounding, very different voices for a lot of these characters, and they are very convincing and different sounding. Like... Len especially, it is like, those are two different vocal ranges for this character alone, and that's not even counting, like, the squad of, like, middle schoolers and the other characters, too. Like, that's a lot of fun.
Fucking Ava.
God bless. But, that must have taken a lot of work, and that must be tricky to keep that balance and have them sound like themselves, but also sounding noticeably different. And I think that's really impressive and a commendable detail that they really committed to, and I like that. The dialogue is also very snappy. I think sometimes it gets maybe a little bit, like, gamery, but it's never reaches a point where it's like, oh. Like, there's a couple of times... How do I describe this? You know, sometimes you'll watch anime where it's like, they kind of sound like they're playing video games, but they don't... sound like they're actually playing video games.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have examples offhand, but sometimes where it's like, there's a couple of times where it's like, oh, that's not how somebody would say that.
Like in Netoge.
I mean, I guess the exact kind of what you're thinking of is how do you do, fellow kids?
Yeah, something like that. I think the one that kills me is anytime... I don't even think this was an anime, but I was watching a thing where they were playing video games, where instead of saying, we need to get XP, they say, we need to get XPs. And every time I hear that, that bugs the shit out of me. It's like, little small details like that bug me, which I really don't think SAO, AGGO had any of that. It's like, sometimes it was pushing it, but for most part, it's like, yeah, no, this is like, I can believe people like this are playing a video game and they're talking casually, or... Oh, wait, actually, you know what's a good example? Like, you know those live public demos they will sometimes do for, like, online matches?
Yes.
Where it's like, you think...
I think I know exactly the one you're thinking of. The E3 demo for Anthem.
I was actually thinking The Division, but yes, Anthem's another one, too, where it's like, they write a script where it's like, you think this is what people playing a game talk, but that's not how they talk. This is more like, ah, You fucking... Ah, goddammit, you got me. You suck. Or you're joking around and being casual. It's like...
Well, according...
The only time...
Well, according to E3, none of the girls in this show would actually ever be playing GGO. We're too busy playing Solitaire and Kim Kardashian's Celebrity Life on our phones, apparently.
Not every day you watch a convention get canceled twice in a row.
Holy shit!
Damn.
Anyways,
holy shit.
I'm kind of rambling, but like I said, Alex has done is very committed to the Sword Art franchise, and for all my thoughts about the series overall, none of my complaints are really about the actual dub quality, which it's always been really consistent, and honestly, I'd even argue, especially in like Alicization, it's done a lot of good work with material that hasn't always hit for me.
Oh boy, Alicization, holy fuck.
War of Underworld is definitely a lot weaker than the first half, if you want my opinion on that. Anyways, SAO, Alternative, GGO, Saugo, pretty good dub. Good job, AVD. Yeah. GG, no re.
Yeah, Roots?
Yeah, so one thing I really have to praise about Sword Art Online, Gungale Online's dub is the way the dialogue is actually written. One complaint I have with particularly Aniplex dubs is sometimes they can feel a bit stiff. I mean, like, when I say stiff, I mean, like, really kind of janky stiff. Drawing a blank a little bit on particular examples. I want to say, like, the first season of Blue Exorcist kind of had that problem.
Yeah, a little bit.
Especially with particular characters, but, Gungale Online feels... It feels a bit looser. It feels a bit more freeform. I know gamer lingo in an anime dub irks some people. Even in situations where it's actually kind of called for. It didn't actually feel unnatural here. To me, it actually kind of enhanced the experience, even though... I mean, let's be real. Gungale Online takes place, I think it was like 6 years from now.
Oh my god, it is 6 years from now. Fuck.
Wow.
And some of the dialogue choices, you know... I want to think there was some sort of meme that was referenced that, you know, is definitely going to be dated by the time.
Was there?
I can't think of any, like, explicit memes that you had.
It was either a meme or some sort of gamer lingo thing that I don't think would be relevant more than a couple years from now. But even then, that didn't actually feel entirely out of place. As for casting, I think that was particularly solid in this case. I know for a couple of characters, either their in-game voice or their IRL voice felt a little awkward, but I think overall, great package. And direction is pretty solid as well. So on the technical...
Actually...
I'm sorry?
Continue. Continue your thing, and then I just had a thought. Brain thing, continue your thing.
Yeah, on the technical side, this is really good stuff.
Okay, what were you going to say, Andrew?
I was just going to say, a thought that occurred to my mind is that... As Sword Art continues to go on... It must get harder and harder to try and figure out who's not been in Sword Art Online yet.
It's like the One Piece of California.
It's like the Fate of California. Oh,
okay, yeah, you got Fate, you got Hunter, those are like the ones where it's like, okay, who have we not casted?
Hunter x Hunter eventually ended, but yeah, no, I see what you... Basically, what I'm trying to say is they did all...
I love how JoJo just got to the point where it's like, now we're gonna go with entirely new actors.
Okay, JoJo's is running into it now. It's mostly just because of the guys, because there's like 100 men in that, though. God, what the fuck was my point? My point was, for the most part, you had to get new people that really hadn't done anything in Sword Art Online up until this point for your spin-off cast, which must have been particularly tricky. And I give them props for getting a really strong, really solid cast of people that, for the most part, hadn't been in Sword Art Online yet. Except for Bryce Papenbrook, which I appreciate the fact that Bryce Papenbrook is just in there as just some heavy machine gun nut guy.
I mean,
that was amazing.
I appreciate that, like, almost nobody else for SAO is in SAO, except Alex was like, hey, Bryce, you want to play a meathead who shoots a gun? It's like, hell yeah!
Anyway, I think Roots was making a point, and you just kind of overran him, my dude.
No. I had finished what I was saying.
It's okay, my Asuna. I will defend your honor.
Yay.
Yay, sorry. You're doing better than Kirito on that job, apparently.
Be gone! Me to Orlethea. Be gone, thought.
So you're done, Andrew?
I'm done, yeah. No, sorry.
Okay. So as for me, I'm a pretty big fan of Alex von Damon's directing work. And just about every one of the dubs he's worked on are among my personal favorites, but I haven't personally seen any of the proper Sword Art Online dub outside of a few out-of-context scenes on Toonami every now and then, so I don't know what its general approach to it is, or if what we got here really matches that at all, but I definitely liked what I heard here. Pretty much every actor more or less knocks it out of the park, and whether it was making me laugh or, like, give me some chills on how crazy some of the characters can be, everyone here sounded like they were having a lot of fun recording this show, and it definitely just made the dub a lot of fun to listen to, and that definitely goes double for any adaptive script. It's probably one of the better examples I've seen of an anime dub handling gamer culture. Like, pretty much all the characters sound like they're on an actual internet voice chat, because they probably are, technically. And they throw out a lot of lingo and occasional one-liners in a way that feels very authentic, but never fears, like... but never goes too far with it, and so doesn't ever veer too far from the Japanese script, I guess. And it really matches with the overall tone of the show, so it balances out really well. And anything that can make a line like "I've got bullet for days, yo" just work really well in context. Again, it's really nice. I got Bryce Papenbrook to shout that line. So anything that can do that really well is a winner in my book, and Alex definitely did a really good job on this. It almost makes me want to give SAO another shot, so yeah, I guess we'll see. If
get us to 5K, baby!
Yep, and with that, we are good to move on to characters. So,
yay.
Okay, so first up, we have a few side characters who briefly show up during the second Squad Jam tourney. We have David, Clarence, and Shirley. David is the leader of Team Memento Mori. Clarence is a player with an Andresenus avatar who briefly hits on Len, and Shirley is part of a team that briefly partners up with Pita Hui, only for her to swear revenge when Pita Hui backstabs her team because, well, that's kind of what she does, I guess.
The correct answer is no man can kill me. I'm no man!
Something like that, yeah.
It's pretty much that one scene from Return of the King. Except for done by a psycho.
Yeah. Playing David, we have Greg Chun. For Clarence, we have Laura Stahl. And for Shirley, we have Judy Toronto. Greg Chun has played such characters as Garo in One Punch Man, Jay Yoon in Last Hope, and Virgo and Tisma in Saint Seiya Lost Canvas. Laura Stahl has played such characters as Mueller in Isekai Cheat Magician, Aigra Akabane in Beyblade Burst Turbo and Ray in The Promised Neverland. And Judy Toronto, on the other hand, has played such characters as Fawn in Black Clover, Zero in Fairytale Zero, and Kaye Shirinuma in Kiss Him, Not Me. So, you know what? I'm gonna keep the order fresh, so you know what? You go first, Roots.
I know he didn't get very much to do, but I like Greg Chun's little serious stoic speech at the start of the second squad jam. And really, the rest of his dialogue for the rest of the show, both in the first and second squad jams, is just leading his troops around. So, not really much to say, but I thought he got the sort of military-ish commander thing pretty down pat. So Clarence, she just gets this really, she's kind of a one-off, but she gets this really great scene in the second squad jam where she's basically hitting on Len. She thinks she's a boy throughout the whole thing. And then it's just like, oh yeah, check my character profile. I'm a girl. And there was like a whole thing like, yeah, don't worry about it. I'm bi.
Okay. I actually forgot about that.
Okay, like, I actually want to talk about that. Because I'm bi. I'll let you finish, but, like,
yeah.
Yeah, I know you have some strong opinions on that.
I'll go after him, okay?
Yeah,
Roots,
yeah,
you finish up first.
I thought in the context of the scene, it was a little... I thought the performance was good, at least. And then Shirley, played by Jeannie Tirado, whose main purpose in the show is to basically get a headshot in, like, right at the last second.
It's a good headshot, too.
Like, it's not really much of a character thing. She does it and then freaks out, and that's basically it. I thought it was alright, but again, like, I'm going off of a handful of lines, so there's really... In the case with all three of these characters, there's really not much to say.
Okay, alright, Megan, I handed you the microphone, the floor is yours.
Okay, so I'll get Shirley out of the way. Shirley is her name?
Yeah.
Shirley,
yeah,
out of the way first. Jeannie was cute and soft-spoken. I liked that she had her little moment of anger, but that character doesn't really do much. Greg Chun sounds imposing, but not, like, in a scary way. Like, you would believe that this guy would kill and is a good strategist. And he sounds very much military commander-y. Laura as Clarence was pretty good. It's the first time I think I've actually listened to Laura play a female character. That being said, Clarence's whole gag is really gross. There's an issue that Sword Art has, and it's the biggest thing that everyone critiques Sword Art for, and that is its reliance on sexual assault to make characters seem bad or creepy. And I think the reason that it pisses me off even more is that this scene comes off right on the heels of another character beating up a dude for saying, once you get killed, your body's an immortal object for 10 minutes, I can grope you and not get flagged.
Oh, okay, yeah, I didn't even think of that.
Oh,
context,
boy.
But... Yeah, it comes...
That scene was ruled.
That scene rules, because that female character beats the living shit out of that dude. But this, it's like, haha, it's okay because it's funny when it's girl on girl. Like... Clarence is incredibly pushy and creepy because Len and, oh god, what the hell is her name? Fuka are both tiny cute girls, and they're an androgynous taller girl that looks like a guy. And he's like, just, I'll give you the things, just kiss me. Come on, you're not gonna leave a character, a guy you're about to kill, like, high and dry. You're gonna steal all my stuff. Just give me a kiss. Like, and they're really pushy about it. And it's just also it's okay, I'm into girls and guys. Really uncomfortable, and especially as me as a bi person, it's like, oh good, my sexuality is a joke to you. SAO. Like, that's just cool. Like, I'm not knocking Laura or the dub for this, this is just the show in general, and oh, trust me, when we get to Pito, I will talk about things Pito. But like, yeah. Not cool, guys.
I'll... Gotcha. Okay.
Gotcha. Okay, Andrew?
I'll say that, admittedly, like I said, I actually kind of forgot about, like, the Memento Mori guy, because it was that he actually had some history with Pito, and it's like, yeah, no, I played with this person. They're nuts crazy. I don't care for that. He's got a whole spiel, and I like the dramatic way he explains about what the Pitohui bird is, and I'm like, oh, that's actually pretty neat. I didn't know that. I think the only time I think the show ever kind of loses me a little as far as the, oh, this is a video game, where everyone's like, you're fucking crazy. You're a psycho. Do you have fun with this? And it's like, here's the thing. I know it's drama, but on the other hand, it's like, yeah, it's a game. Did we forget this? This is a video game. I know drama, but it's like, yes, of course they're having fun. Like, look at how rad this fucking beam sword katana is. It's fucking cool.
I mean...
I don't know.
I do sort of like the halfway... how serious is everybody taking this kind of meta thing to the whole... to the whole show.
I guess... though granted that there's a conversation about Pitohui's own ethics being at question where it's like, yeah, no, I feel bad about shooting somebody defenseless and then going into Shirley literally shoots her entire team when they have their back turned to her and they're literally have amnesty and aren't attacking her. It's like, what's your deal, Pito? Do you even fucking care or are you just trying to get off? Anyways,
yes.
Yo, Greg Chun, he's a good voice. Touche. Greg Chun, great voice actor. He's very cool at this stuff. He does a good job. He also gets to be in SAO later as his own,
Oh, yeah.
SAO villain. Which, if you know what SAO villains are, you know what SAO villains are. Anyways. Ginny, Shirley, don't call me Shirley. She's cute. She knows how to use a gun IRL. She gets a really good headshot. She's kind of cute. And then she's like, I don't want to hurt people because it's like shooting real people and that's not cool. And then she's like, oh no, this girl's a fucking animal. I'm gonna destroy her. And honestly, she was right to do so.
Well, I mean, you're not wrong, Shirley.
Until it didn't
work. She
got
a clean headshot. She got the eyeball too. It's like, ooh, you got her good.
Yeah, this show, thank God, this show would have been a lot better if they used actual blood spray instead of digital blood spray, just saying.
Which I'm still confused that why the show is rated TV-MA.
I mean,
like,
a dude's head gets slashed in half.
True, but it's, like, virtual.
I mean, the,
It's like the anime equivalent of saying fuck once in a Disney movie.
Should have just gone the Danganronpa approach.
Oh God! This
then nobody so much... then nobody would be able to find Len.
God, you're right. Oh God, that's fucking. I actually like that. But yeah, no, Genie does a good job. She also gets to be a girl later on in Alicization, who shows up and then pops back up later. Clarence, Laura Stahl is a very, very talented voice actress who I will absolutely get the chance to talk about in another dub, in another show later this year. Hint, hint, wink, wink, nudge, nudge. I think she does a really good job playing Clarence. I had seen the show before. I actually forgot what Clarence's deal was. I was trying to remember, okay, are you like an actual 13-year-old boy or are you a girl that looks like a boy? And then it was a girl who looks like a boy who also is into girls and guys and all that stuff. I just forgot how casually, oh yeah, I'm bi, cool. Which, I think, like I said, I don't think I was as upset by it, but I understand why you, I actually understand why you are upset by it now, Megan, and I totally get it. I will say the biggest problem with Clarence and the whole scene itself is that it literally just kind of breaks the flow of the show. It's very much a... oh, I hate to use this particular phrase for obvious reasons. It's very much a literal big-lipped alligator moment.
Big-lipped alligator moment.
Where it literally, it happens. It occurs. It's almost never referenced again. The only thing it accomplishes is Len has more ammo to waste now, which... can we talk about the fact that she is so bad with ammo conservation? I know it's a P90 and that shit, like, shoots, like, 30 a second, but, like, There was a dude who was right there on the ground, and she shot, like, 3 mags worth of clips into him. Like, come on, girl.
I mean, she was fucking pissed. I'd do it, too.
Alright, touche. Anyways, yeah, no, like, the stuff with Clarence, like, it's a weird character, but I think Laura does a great job, and she's really, she's actually does a good job selling this character as sort of like a playboy handsome girl, which, Clarence IRL is probably like a trucker who wears the, women want me, fish fear me hat.
No, Clarence is also a girl in real life, remember?
Yeah, no, I just imagine Clarence is a girl IRL who wears, like, trucker hats.
Oh, so you're saying she's Fema Blywith. Women want me, fish fear me!
No comments. Anyways, yeah, those are my thoughts on those characters.
Okay, I don't have too much to say on Greg June. He's just kind of there in the background for a lot of the show, but I thought he did a pretty good job. He had a very, like, kind of military commander-ish voice out to him that I thought was really cool. I also did like, as Andrew was saying, that he clearly had some kind of prior history with Pito and how he was, and how he explained to me behind her name and how she, and how kind of crazy she could be in all their previous game sessions, so I thought that whole conversation was kind of interesting. I wish I had a little more to say, but he's not a huge presence in the show, but it was pretty fun hearing Greg. It's always nice hearing new things.
It's always fun to see him watch his head.
Yeah.
he got to experience what it was like to go against Darth Maul in episode 1.
Okay, look.
Somebody,
if this was a
all right, Jackson. I need you to do me a solid and get that scene where Pito stabs him through the face with his friend and put Duel of Fates behind it.
Oh, God. I'd say not to do that on the actual episode just because we're dealing with Aniplex here.
And the mouse. Huh?
Oh, God. But yeah,
welcome to my own death game, motherfuckers!
Okay, if this was a real video game...
I've already taken out that rat, Charles Entertainment. Jeez, aw.
God damn
Keep it.
It
up or you'll never get Twisted Wonderland!
Oh, I don't even know. Where was I going with this? I don't even remember. Jack, continue.
And I just reminded me of, like, the No More Heroes version of, like, where they introduced Chuck E. Cheese, and I'm just kind of amazed that's a real thing that exists now.
Charles Entertainment Cheese. God, I hope they bring that voice back for No More Heroes 3.
Moving on to Shirley. She was just kind of more or less there to go nuts when Pito backstabbed her team, but I thought Jeannie did a really good job. But regardless, we didn't hear too much of her before she stepped. But I was kind of amused by how she went from not liking to shoot people even in a video game to I will hunt this chick down to the very end of the earth. And it was definitely as wild as it was silly. And Jeannie was clearly having a lot of fun playing Shirley. Especially when she saw Jane taking out Pito only to die trying. And I just like the line where it's like I won't kill people, but I will exterminate vermin. So it just reminds me so much of like that one bit from SA where it's like, we can't kill children, but we can kill guilty children, right?
Oh what? God! Okay. Okay, so there's a whole thing in, like, Iron-Blooded Orphans where it's like, we can't fight them, they're children. But then there's one guy who's really mad at them for killing, like, his mentor where it's like, but we can kill
only if you teabag on
him, right?
With your giant mech. Could you imagine somebody using a Gundam to teabag?
Kids get it.
Michael Bay's mobile suit Gundam. No way. Guys.
What?
Guys, Michael Bay's mobile suit Gundam where all the Gundams have truck nut balls and they start teabagging each other.
If Gundam Build Fighters was real, somebody would totally do that.
But it's the one he deserves.
Oh, I hate this. This is not the world Tomino fought for.
True. So as for Lauren Stahl's clearance, the first time I watched this show, I was more than a little surprised to see Len Fuca's Humphrey suddenly get tracked by this character. But I was just like, and the whole scene was a little weird, but I was definitely pretty amused by Lauren's performance. Lauren's delivery definitely made the whole scene a little more amusing than I guess it would have been otherwise. I didn't have too much of a problem with it the first couple of times I watched it, but I definitely do see where Megan's point of view comes in, and like, as I guess from that perspective, yeah, that whole scene is really kind of weird. But regardless, I do think Laura did a pretty good job here. And her acting definitely helped to make it work. I think the reason this happened at all was that I remember hearing something about this character might be relevant in later novels, but I don't totally remember. If that's the case, I guess that's why they threw this scene in, but otherwise it's just kind of...
It could be, but I don't even know, man.
Like, hey, Chris Patton's in that.
There's a lot of SAO lore. All I know is I apparently need to watch the movie now.
So anyway, all three of these performances were good. Lore in particular stood out, even if it wasn't entirely under the best circumstances. I thought she was still really having a lot of fun here. But anyway, let's talk about some more fun characters. Particularly, we have the girls of Team Sig. They are a group of players with butch female avatars who are, in reality, a bunch of small high school girls on a gymnastics
team. They're just small.
Okay, so they are high school girls.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, my brain thought they were middle school.
So did I.
It definitely looks that way, but I've watched it a couple of times. I'm pretty sure they said high school.
Okay. I mean, literally...
It still doesn't change the fact that they're murder poppets.
Yes.
Lord.
Hello, sir. Spare a cup of blood.
Yep, and so, anyway, said team is composed of Ava, Anna, Rosa, Sophie, Tanya, and Toma. Ava is played by Cindy Robinson. Anna is played by Zanfi Nguyen. Rosa is played by Rebecca Davis. Sophie is played by Wendy Lee. Tanya is played by Morgan Berry. And Toma is played by Kira Buckland. Cindy Robinson has played such characters as Queen Beryl in Sailor Moon, Yuen Amada in Digimon Fusion, and Balsa in Morimoto, Guardian of the Spirit. Zanfi Nguyen has played such characters as Aiko Tachibana in the Bangzoom redub of Aiko Incarnation, Nira in Dragon Quest Your Story, and Alice in Fate Extra Last Encore. Rebecca Davis has played such characters as Akemi Miyano in Detective Conan Episode 1, Tomoe in Yuroni Kenshin Trust and Betrayal, and Meiko Yotsuba in Sakura Diaries, because apparently she's been in a lot of older stuff. Wendy Lee has played such characters as Faye Valentine in Cowboy Bebop, Shiroki Gakure in Blue Exorcist, and Bulma, I mean Lena, in the Lost Harmony Golden Dragon Ball, because I just felt like bringing that up today.
I know. God, that's such a deep cut.
Oh no, I got a deeper cut for our good friend who likes Sword Art Online. Remember that she's Haruhi Suzumiya.
I was gonna mention that she's Konata because her IRL voice is literally just Konata Izumi from Lucky Star.
Continuing, Morgan Berry has played such characters as Akihiro Arai in Barakamon, Dragon Panther in Cutie Honey Universe, and 13 in My Hero Academia.
And just because I'm not going to remember this, she also shows up in Sword Art Online Alicization and gets a really cool weapon.
She looks like Ignatz from Three Houses in that show.
Oh, fuck, you're right.
That character looks like Ignatz.
Yep, lastly, Kira Buckland has played such characters as Beatrice in ReZero, Mary Sautome in Kakegurui, and the run true best Kawahara girl, Kiryuki Hime in Excel World.
Alright. So before we go on, we are doing this audio. Viewer on YouTube, you see what their pictures are. We need to remember who is who and what is what, because all of them are kind of... They are a squad, but they can be kind of interchangeable. Alright, so, Wendy and Rebecca are the two big meathead girls. Kira is the blue-haired rifle girl. Morgan is the white-haired SMG girl. Xanthi is the blonde girl with sunglasses. And Cindy is the big, big boss lady girl.
Yep. You know what? Why don't you go first, Andrew?
Okay, I'm looking at this because I literally had to pull up pictures to remember this because this was going to bother me. Okay. So, Rebecca Davis does a pretty good job sounding like a buff meathead girl. She's probably the one I have the least to say because she's the one I'm the least familiar with. Wendy Lee, she does a really good job sounding like a badass, like, buff lady. And she also makes a really goddamn good shield. Here's why I like team game shit, because you can do really cool strategies where it's like, hey, here's the thing that I think GGO does better than Sword Art's own Gun Gale Online arc. They seem to have a better understanding of their own rules and kind of use them, where it's basically, hey, somebody who dies, their body turns into an immortal object. And that turns into a strategy, because they literally kill Sophie, and then they use her to support their fucking anti-tank rifle to destroy M's shield as they do an on-frontal assault and do a pincer attack. And it's like, I like cool strategy shit like that. That's rad. She makes a good shield, and yeah, baby Sophie sounds just like Konata Izumi. And I appreciate that, because when I was first watching this, I got off my Lucky Star rewatch. I'm like, oh shit, that's just Konata. Toma, I actually did not recognize that was Kira Buckland at first. I was genuinely surprised. I'm like, oh, rad. Kira Buckland, she does a lot of stuff, and she's really good at it, and she must have been somebody in Sword Art. I'm trying to remember who else was in Sword Art. Okay.
Sarah Williams,
No, I don't think she actually was in the original Sword. No, you're right. She's in the other Kawahara thing. She's Kuroyuki Hime. That's what you meant. Okay. Never mind. I did not realize that was Kira Buckland. She does a good job. Xanthi, I was surprised that was Xanthi because, like, baby Xanthi sounds like baby Xanthi, but, like, badass, like, American-looking girl was definitely, like, action girl movie Xanthi, which was really interesting. Morgan Berry just sounds like Morgan Berry in both forms. Like, Morgan's got a very unmistakable tone of voice. She's very cool, and I like her SMG. It's like, I feel like I've used her gun in Call of Duty before. Like, you can very much tell this series was done by a gun nut because all these look like real guns. But yeah, Morgan does a good job. Cindy does a really, really good job as Ava. I think she sometimes has some trouble doing baby Ava, because I think she's probably like 40, I think she's in her 40s or 50s, something like that. So I think it's pushing it a little for her. That said, she does still do a really good job, and I think she's definitely like one of the more entertaining voice. I just love her gruff and tumble voice where it's like, I know you were talking about it earlier, Megan. It's like, there's a scene where she's literally harassing a bunch of guys where it's like, come on, do none of you have the balls to face me? And it's like, Ava, come on. If you start cursing in the game, you'll curse in real life. It's like, all right, fine. Do none of you have the testicles to face me? And I'm like, oh. Oh, that's such a good thing. And I love her battle with Len. It's like, it's such a good little conflict. The girl squad is hilarious, and just the juxtaposition of these really adorable gymnastic girls who are playing a violent apocalyptic team shooter game to better
so that they can better the teamwork.
What's gonna work? Teamwork.
Teamwork.
What's gonna work? Camping.
I'm gonna camp on your grave, bitch.
Okay, that's me. Don't call them campers. They're totally the type who would probably go around destroying campers.
Oh, you're okay. You know what? You're right. They've actually got like a good team balance, which probably makes them like OP as hell. So yeah. In conclusion, I love these girls. They are adorable. They are precious. They are hilarious. Look, all I know is, All right, which of these six little girls do you think is going to be the first to say fuck? Probably Ava, followed promptly by... I'm going to say Kira's girl. She seems like she could use the fuck word. The only one I don't believe will say fuck will be Morkenberry's girl. She seems like a very good girl who will never say fuck in her life. Anyways, I'm done. I just love the stupid character dynamic. They're actually, like, one of my favorite parts of the show.
Roots?
Yeah, I have to echo a lot of what Andrew said. Like, particularly with their introduction to the story as, like, a group of these little high school girls who compliment Karen on the fact that she's so tall. And then it turns out that the big team of the squad jam, or the first squad jam, is these little teen girls. The teen girl squad.
Damn it, you stole my joke!
Oh no, I'm sorry!
Teen girl squad! Featuring backup Trogdar and Homestar Runner.
Cheerleader! So-and-so! What's her face? The ugly one!
Trogdar! Trogdar! Just imagine Trog... Imagine if Trogdar...
I mean...
Imagine if Trogdar was in Sword Art.
Population! Oh...
It happens after he let it out 2 years ago.
Just a dragon with a big old muscly arm. Okay, anyway. Getting back onto the subject at hand. All the girls in their Gungale Online forms, their actor counterparts did a really great job with them. Particularly with Cindy Robinson as Ava, and one other one that I can't quite put my finger on. They had a little bit of trouble, in my opinion, with the with their actual real world high school forms. Like, it's nothing that is detrimental to the dub of the show. You just kind of realize that the squad of... It's a little jarring. I'll leave it at that. And Cindy Robinson is Ava, who's pretty much... I'm sorry, the only one I could really pick out of the group and put a name to a face. She is... absolutely a tour de force in this show, in the Gungale Online segments. She banters off of everyone she encounters. And it's just absolutely wonderful watching her just absolutely go to town against just about everyone that we're about to talk about. Particularly her first fight against Len was really great. Where she is just... She underestimates her, and... As she's just wiping out her entire squad, it's... It's just good stuff. You gotta check that out. So, overall, I think they all did a really good job with what they had. It's just a little jarring when you move on to their real-world counterparts.
Yeah, that's fair. Megan?
Okay, so... I like the girls' voices when they're out of... when they're in GGO more than I like it when they're out for some of them. I think that they're all pretty good. I really, unfortunately, don't have a lot to say about Anna, Rosa, and Tanya, and Toma. The thing is that they all kind of sounded really similar out of game for me, so it was hard to tell them apart, like, if I turned my head. I can't say that about Though I can't actually say that about Tanya, because I'm so used to Morgan Berry's voice, I will know where Morgan Berry is at all times in the game, in the show. Sophie, to me, was the strongest of them for both sides of the show, where they have to be the little girl outside of the game and the girl inside of the game. Also be just... whatever one yells, I got to shoot an anti-tank rifle! Is, like, one of my highlights of the show.
Because they're like, yo, this thing's rad, I love it.
Rad. They also apparently got it from Shinon, so, which is even funnier.
Oh yeah, that's canon, they got it from Shinon. That's funny.
To which, I just imagine Shinon being, eh, I'm done with this, I'm going to Alfheim, take it. But, to me, though, I really want to talk about Cindy Robinson, because I think she's the standout of this for, in, like, a double-edged sword type of way. I think her as Ava in the game is fantastic. She is big, buff, but she doesn't do, like, a big, like, stereotypical accent or, like, bigger girl, like, fat voice. But I think out of the game, you can tell Cindy Robinson is pushing it with her voice to the point where I thought it came off as a little fake. It took a little bit to get used to, but by the end of it, I thought she was pretty all right. Yeah, that's all I have.
I can get through most of the shit girls pretty quick, since, with the exception of Ava, they do kind of all blend together. That's simply not a bad thing, since it definitely does seem, but that's sort of the point here. I think that Safi, Rebecca, Wendy, and Kira all did a really good job here. I like that there was a really clear contrast between the adult voices in the game and how cutesy they sounded in reality. I'm not, like, super familiar with Rebecca Davis, but I'm pretty familiar with Wendy Lee's range at this point, so I wasn't, like, super thrown off by the contrast between their voices. But it was kind of shocking for Kira and Danfi, and especially Danfi. I've heard Kira do kind of deeper adultish voices in another show we'll be talking about soon, but this was a little gruffer than that one was. And Zephy's in is definitely the deepest I've ever heard her voice goes, and since I'm used to her playing kind of cutesy characters or young girls, seeing her pull that off was kind of a really big 180, and I thought that that was pretty impressive. And I was appreciating that while most of them were just kind of in the background, they had a lot of really good rapport, and you kind of got the impression that they were all really good friends, and I liked how they had a lot of really good banter every now and then. Of course, the real star of this section is Cindy Robinson as Ava, and she really stands out. Cindy Robinson as an actress is a little underrated for how long she's been around, but she's really good at playing sultry older women or older women who are authority figures. So her as a military commander wannabe certainly sounds about right. And she does a really good job of giving Ava a very commanding presence. When she's on the battlefield, her overall tone just kind of tells her right away why she's in charge of this group of ladies, and why she isn't somebody you'd want to cross paths with. This makes her dynamic with Len all the more fun, because both their character designs and voices kind of come off as total opposites, and there's something really fun about Cindy using this ultra-butch military lady voice while she's desperately trying to take out a short girl in a pink jumpsuit in a video game. And when Len eventually beats her, a lot of that rage kind of shifts to respect. And you can tell that she sees Len as both a worthy rival and a good friend without losing too much of the gruffness in her voice that makes a lot of this performance fun. But all that said, the really mind-blowing thing here is, of course, the contrast between Ava's voice in the game and the cutesy, proper boy-girl voice he has in the real world. While I've actually heard Cindy Robinson play teenagers before, and even Ewan in Digimon Fusion, who was a little boy, so I know she can go higher pitch when she needs to. But coming off of roles like Balsa, Queen Beryl, and especially Ava in the game, hearing Cindy pull off this kind of voice was some pretty wild whiplash. And while you can tell she is maybe straining herself a little bit to maintain it, I thought she did a pretty good job of making her sound sweet and proper while still very openly harboring a desire to duel that led to the death of the game. I just got a really good kick out of her, like, texting Karen, and she's like, she's like, come on, play with the game. I really want to fight Lynn. I want to fight to the death of her. I want to kill her. And it's just like this really... and she just sounds really super excited about it. It was kind of funny.
I'm here to murder you.
That's right. And I don't think it's kind of dug that after we got to meet the real Ava, she still keeps up the whole commander stick in the game. And we do see more of her actual personality leak out a couple of times. And again, like the rest of you, I really did nearly die about hearing the line, "Do you not have the testicles to face us?" I thought that was pretty funny.
I've got big balls.
And so, yeah, Cindy was definitely a lot of fun here, and I'm definitely really glad they casted her because she did a really fantastic job. And with that, we are good to start moving on to our main four. So, first up, we have Goshi Isoki, better known as M. He partners up with Len during the first squad jam at Pito's request, and later teamed up with Pito to fight Len during the second squad jam. To put things mildly, he's madly in love with Pito and will do practically anything for her. And we do mean anything.
Oh, God.
Dial M for masochist.
Yes, that is in fact a joke. Anyway, playing M, we have one Mr. Ray Chase, who has played such characters as Masamune Goto and Mars Comes In Like a Lion, Russell Elion in Mobile Suit Gundam Iron Blooded Orphans, and Ace Killer in Ultraman. So, why don't you go first, Megan?
Boy, howdy. So, Ray Chase also does a fantastic job differentiating between M in the game and his real life. In real life, he sounds like your traditional, like, normal anime guy. Even though Ray Chase kind of goes all over the map, he sounds like he would fit just at home in, like, Free or Prince of Stride, like, a slice of lifey show. And then his in-game voice is very much like Bruno Bucciarati if Bruno aged 50 years. Which can never happen. I'm gonna zip my mouth on that
that's
one.
That's a deep cut.
You zip that up, man.
Ah. I've got sticky fingers.
Oh, no.
And so does M when Pito's done with him.
Oh! No. Wow, this escalated hard.
I drank sparkling water right after I said that, and I had to, like, hold in my laughter so it wouldn't come through my nose. Okay, so the part in the game where he loses it about how Pito's gonna kill him is absolutely hysterical in Ray's part, because he's gotta do that big, deep, gruff, like, older guy voice. Because remember, Ray Chase is a man with enough range where he can play his own father. I think you can be the judge of that! Fuck you guys.
Okay, you're looking forward to the hot zone right now.
Anyway, I think Ray does a really good job here. I like... Oh, God. M is just such this weird, uncomfortable character to talk about.
Oh, God, is it?
Oh, boy, when we get to Pito Hui. Oh, boy. I think that they do play off really well of Pito's actor being the straight man in this, because Pito is a little crazy. So Ray does a really good job as Goshi. I like when he freaks out. I like when he's the real world him that's a little softer spoken. And okay, so the part where him and Karen are talking in the real world, and he's telling Karen that she has to enter squad jam too so that Pito won't kill herself and him, and Karen goes, "Can't you call a cop or a therapist?" And this, the pathetic, "No." And she also just him. God, when I get to Karen, I want to talk about her reactions to his bullshit. But no, Ray does a really good job in this. And I like that Ray can show his range in just one character. And I think that's a big compliment to the entire dub. But Ray is one of those characters who really gets that. So, good job.
Okay, Andrew.
I will also continue to say that I like the fact that, like, really pretty boy Ray is just this very, like, meek, like, lover boy, also maybe a stalker? Wait, not almost a stalker. Is?
He is a stalker.
And then he just became her manager because she's like, yo, that's hot. Let me beat you up. Which, great chase. Anyways, so, pretty handsome boy that puts his wall slams her. And I love her reaction. Oh god, first time I've ever been wall slammed, and he confesses to
she
about another
to
girl.
Another girl.
Like, ugh, fucking hell. Yeah, no, just he's got this very like soft spoken, like very handsome voice, and then like as M, he's got this really gruff, strong, commanding tone of voice, but also like a bit of a weird casual gun nut, where he just talks kind of slowly. I like the way he sit. Oh god, I'm gonna get my ass kicked for this. He says, yep, like Big Mac from My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic.
My little gun nut, my little gun nut.
He says fuck you. Like, he does it. It sounds like Big Mac, kind of, yep.
My little gun nut is something that airs on O-O-A-N-N.
But yeah, no, fucking Christ. He's got this very, like, booming, commanding strength to him. And then he cries like hell because he's like, oh shit, I don't want to actually die. But I'm so in love with this girl and I don't want her to die. Because if she dies, I die. And then it's like the strength that he's containing this character voice and still being like, don't shoot, don't shoot, is really impressive and well done. Like,
Glenn's over there like, that's rough, buddy.
I love the face she makes at the end of episode 4. It's just this very confused, what the fuck have I gotten myself into face? It's great. But yeah, no, Ray Chase, he's a fantastic actor. He's killing it as M. Though I'm less than comfortable with the character. Holy shit, Ray sells it hard.
Roots?
Yeah, so, god, Ray Chase plays such an interesting, like, you know what, I'm gonna say it, he's a simp. M is a simp.
When you're a simp all the way.
From your first cigarette to your last dying day. The simps are all here. God, now I'm imagining him trying to do ballet. Like, Jesus.
West Side simping.
Oh. But Ray Chase does it so well. Like, oh my god. Like, his wimpy form. Just plays off that just lover boy nature so well. And he tries to act all big and stoic in Gun Gale Online, but when it's revealed exactly what he is there to do, and he tries to pull a gun on Len and she manages to get the better of him.
Because he spent so much time training her. Had he not put so much effort into training her, it wouldn't have ended like that.
She became too good.
Hoisted by his own petard. Yeah. But it's just this beautiful moment where he's blubbering and begging for his life, and it's absolutely hilarious. I don't actually have too much to say about M, but it's such a fun performance. You know, especially when he's going over his backstory and he shows off the pictures and he's just this chubby boy who works so hard for Pito that he sheds all of the weight, and I just found it kind of funny, and it's a great performance overall.
Okay. So for me, Chase has a pretty wide vocal range. He tends to get cast as gruff older men a lot of the time. And his role here kind of continues that tradition. And when we first meet, Abby comes off as a seasoned veteran, even if, you know, by seasoned veteran, we mean more along the lines of seasoned gamer. And Ray doesn't really get off of making him sound very stoic and knowledgeable, as well as the kind of guy who's seen more than his fair share of fighting. And it kind of makes his whole rapport with Flan all the better, since he kind of acts like a mentor towards her in the beginning, helping her to get through the first squadron tourney. And while also having, like, just enough respect for her skill not to, like, bail her out of any tough situations. That whole super serious attitude definitely makes things all the funnier when Em drops him aside upon discovering that Pito will literally murder him if he loses. And just hearing this super gruff-sounding man cry like a 5-year-old because of how scared he is just really had me rolling. And Ray's over-the-top delivery of that whole exchange between him and Len where he's just begging for his life is definitely some grade-A comedy. And it's definitely one of the funniest things in the entire show. And the punchline only gets better when we meet Em in person, and Ray does a really good job of making him sound like a young adult. I mean, I don't know exactly how old this dude is supposed to be. And his voice definitely sounds a lot lighter compared to his in-game counterpart, and definitely a lot nerdier. Ray definitely does a really good job of making Gochi come off as kind of an asocial nerd, and while he's respectful enough to Karen and Miyu, he definitely tends to be very blunt about his feelings, especially when it comes to Pito. Since there's quite a bit we don't know about the real Pito, and we'll get to that in a second, it's hard to say if Gochi's dynamic with her is weird, nasty, or both. But definitely got a good kick out of Ray's delivery when Gochi explained out of two of them met. And just hearing him talk how he went from socking her to being lovely and abused by her in, like, the most matter-of-fact way possible was kind of funny.
Yeah, I couldn't go to college because I was going to be threatened. Yo, that was the best time of my life.
My life.
Like, and then, like, literally just, her friend is just like, all right, okay, I thought you were hot, and now you are not. I'm getting the fuck out of here.
Fuck out of this.
She would have rolled off the highway if she could have.
Like, also now that I realize it, now that line earlier on where, I think Pito calls him a criminal.
Oh.
At one point, like, when she's describing him to Len, I think she calls him a criminal.
Oh, yeah, she does.
Good lord.
This has layers like an onion that I didn't expect.
Yep. But yeah. Like, holy shit, that's an unhealthy relationship right there. Good lord. Oh, lord.
Yeah! Holy fuck!
But yes, like, we joke about him simping, but...
Yeah.
He's simping!
Yeah, that is a very unhealthy relationship.
There's simping, and then there's, okay, these two were in an abusive relationship that's played for kicks.
You do get the sense that he is at least sincere in how he cares about Pito, even if he really should have gotten her a therapist. And Ray definitely gets that across pretty well in both the episode and with Gochi's actual personality. And while I know Ray Chase can be funny, this was definitely one of the funnier performances I've seen from him in a while. And I really liked how well he balanced both that and the whole super story gamer thing, so it was really well done. And I really would like to hear Ray Chase do more comedy roles. If only one of the big ones he's in would finally get released.
Someday it will return from the war.
Wait, what?
Osomatsu-san.
Oh.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure Viz is just, like, Weekend at Burnings, its corpse around the city of Miami.
Yep, I'm so annoyed because Ray's the best one, and I'm sad.
Someday, Jet.
Somewhere out there, beneath the pale moonlight, someone's thinking of me and releasing the Matsu brothers tonight.
Okay.
Okay, so anyway, next up,
Megan, you get an M for effort.
Fuck off.
That was bad.
Yeah.
Anyway, next up we have Miyu Shinohara, who goes by the handle Fuka Zero, or Fuka for short. She is Karen's best friend and teams up with her for the second squadron tourney to help save Peter Hui. Also, she is by far the best character. Anyway, playing Fuka, we have Feimata. Feimata has played such characters as Lily Hoshino in Be the Beginning, Astolfo in Fate Apocrypha, and Aqua in Konosuba. Can you go first, Roots?
Yeah. When you're first introduced to her, she doesn't do too much through the first probably 5 or 6 episodes of the show, mainly acting as kind of a foil to Karen. And it's when she finally decides to join Gale Online to help out with the second squad jam that she really begins to develop into her own character. I particularly like the scene when she's first being introduced to the world of Gale Online, and she's trying to find a gun that suits her. And then she finds the grenade launcher. And she is so enamored by this thing, she has to buy 2 of them. Because, M is basically helping them out in order to, you know, prevent Pito from doing something stupid.
Simping ain't easy, people. Simping ain't easy.
So she buys 2 of them, and Karen's freaking out, and she's just saying, oh, yeah, don't worry about it, don't worry about it. We got a sugar daddy now. And then just keeps repeating the words sugar daddy.
At nauseam.
And it is the absolute funniest thing in this show. She also comes in the clutch a lot during the second squad jam.
Oh, she rules.
And she is absolutely badass, and I hope at some point we get another season of Gale Online, because I just want to see more of her and her interactions with the characters around her.
Remember when she shoots a dude's head off with a grenade?
Yes!
That was rad.
And she also bludgeons a dude with the face with the butt of the gun.
Okay, that is my favorite part of the entire show, and the best thing that has ever happened in Sword Art. Fuck you, fight me!
The line was, and I quote, "I smite thee in the name of all women."
Oh.
Man, I love the guys in the bar who watch it, and they're like, man, chicks who play fantasy stuff do not fuck around.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God.
Like, the other thing that really is great about that whole scene is that it's like a back-to-back of... right before what happens is a bunch of dude bros in a bar go, oh, all the girls are gonna be like, oh, help me, I'm a princess. Pito proceeds to brutally murder a bunch of motherfuckers. Then you cut to Len and Fuka doing it, and it ends with Fuka beating the dude to death with the butt of his gun. Not her gun, his gun.
Yep.
After she proceeds to miss every shot with her pistol because she hasn't trained on using it. So she just goes back to her old tried and true, bludgeoning him to death with a gun. And even then, that's not even the most metal death in the show.
Yeah.
I also want to know, why don't you go back in?
Roots, are you done?
Yeah, I'm all set.
Oh man, I fucking love Feimata as Fuka. It's the best performance in the show to me. Like, I have always really liked Feimata's acting, ever since Love Live, because she is my best girl in Love Live, of course. No bias there at all, I promise. But to me, Fuka brings this great balance of absolute comedy and absolute trauma, because face it, Fuka's the one who's pretty much, she's got to do this thing even when she's in the cutesy little girl body where she has to pull her deeper voice to pull Karen out of her funk, because Karen's like, what do I do? Everyone's running in and they're going to get killed. We're not going to be able to save Len. And she's like, bitch, shut the fuck. We're not going to be able to save Pito. And she's just like, bitch, I got this. Stop thinking. Turn off your brain. Just go for the frag time, my dude. And just, she's so funny. To me, the other really funny part of her introduction is when she first gets her body in GGO, and there's that one guy who's like, oh my god, your avatar is so cute, I want your avatar. And she's like, how yes. much? And obviously, Len is like, no! What are you doing? What the fuck? And Fuka's like, no, it's okay. I just wanted to fuck around with him. And then I think they go out for drinks in that body, and as she's leaving, she goes, I'm gonna go out and see how many dudes creep on me.
Like, I love that part so much, where she's like, okay, you do your shit, I'm bored, let's see how many dudes are creeping.
I'm gonna
creep
on me.
43!
And I think...
Wow.
And Faye brings such this wonderful bubbly energy. And I love how, like, overdramatic she is about, like, the whole Squad Jam game, like, where she gets her fucking legs blown off. And she's like, go on without me, da-da-da. And Len's like, give it 2 minutes, your legs will regenerate.
And then she ties her to her other grenade launcher, literally by her shoes. And it's like, only the strongest chosen one can get their rightful place in the castle. Haha, very funny. Get me the fuck out of this.
Get me out of here. Also, I love when they're driving in the Jeep and she's like, why can't you go faster? We're out of gas!
Oh, God.
Oh, no. Hey there, pretty lady. Do you need a ride?
I think I wrote the actual line down. Hang on. Sup, girl? Damn, you look so fine. Want to go for a ride?
Ride? Like, Faye is, to me, the person I think who is having the most fun in this dub.
She's playing a game.
That's what it is. I think that she gets across the best that this is just a dumb 20-something-year-old. Like, okay, she's like 19. That's right. Because she's like, I'm a teenager. Because I remember when they're in the car with M, and she's like, I'm still a teenager. And it's like, oh yeah, Len just turned 20.
You should give her something, Karen, buddy. It's like, thing. No thanks.
And he's like, nah, fam, I'm straight. I realize that doesn't work because Len's a woman. But no, I love Faye because she's just so charismatic and charming, in a sense. So, like, I think she gets it across really well. And I think she's absolutely right. And it's a real shame that it took so long for, I think, a lot of people to wake up on Faye Mata as an actress. Like, I feel like, of all the things, like, I've liked her since, like, Love Live, and people are now just finding her because of, like, Konosuba and Fire Emblem. And also, I think Faye probably has a lot of, like, good way to get, like, the gamer girl vibe across, because I'm pretty sure she can beat all of her asses in Smash.
Oh, fucking probably.
Yeah, Faye Mata would probably take my lunch money in Smash.
It's canon.
Anyway, I'm done.
Okay. Andrew...
oh god, where do I even start? Fuck. So, I'm just going to read off a couple of, like, my favorite lines that she has said. I think we've gotten a lot of them already. I'm gonna see if there's any others. But no, there is just... You can tell she is having the time of her life. And she is just so fucking fun. She's having the blast. She's having the time of her life. It's like, oh, there's melodrama going on. I'm here for the fun of it. I saw these guns that shoot grenades and I fell in love. And now I'm going to rain death from above. This is the best day of my life. Like, she is just charming. She is having a blast. She's having a ball. Faye sounds like she's having so much fun. She is a level of charming, like, high school, college age girl who plays video games that is just having a ball. Because it's like, I feel like Faye knows what this is to be like, and she's just having a blast. I love how she just also fucks with her... Like, she's a good, supportive friend that fucks with her friends and jokes around with her friends, too. It's like, hey, yo, I'm taking pictures of your new haircut. Oh, you're looking hot. Very hot. Now lose the sweater. It's like, ah, okay, you're a bitch. I love you. And then she's like, don't worry about the price. We got a sugar daddy. Like, every time she does something and she has a fun time with her grenades and she's just shooting the shit, like, she is the character that is the most having the fun with this plot. And that's why I'm having, like, the most fun listening to her. Faye is just infectious. She is infectious as this character. She is so fun. She's just a delight every time she's on screen and she's in this game. Like, oh, she's so funny. She is so charming. Oh, she is best teammate. She's best girl. Faye, so good. I love her. I'm done.
Okay. So I know Faye's role as Aqua is kind of held up as her funniest performance, and I definitely got a lot of laughs out of her in that dub, but honestly, I think her Fuka kind of messes that out. A lot of what's interesting about this dub is how there's a clear contrast between the personas a lot of the characters put on while playing GGO, and what their actual personalities are like in reality. What's fun about Fuka, though, is that there's basically no filter between those two. When we meet her as Karen's childhood friend Miu, she comes off as very carefree and spontaneous. And when she starts playing GGO with Fuka, she pretty much just doubles down on that. And compared to all the other gamers in the show who are treating the states of these matches like they're a matter of life or death, Fuka is definitely the one who's just clearly very much out to have a good time, and Faye's performance definitely reflects that. And whether it's wondering if Em is secretly Len's sugar daddy, almost being late to the tournament because she picked that on ice cream, or pretending to catcall Len after she saved him from Vito, Fuka just sounds like she's taking absolutely none of what's happening seriously. And while that might be annoying under different circumstances, it kind of makes her a breath of fresh air. And pretty much all of her lines had me rolling. It definitely helps that Faye wasn't afraid to flex her range a bit to help punch up some of her lines. It definitely made a lot of her delivery funnier. And of course, while Fuka isn't like super serious a lot of the time, you can definitely know she's doing her best to look out for her friend. And Faye gets that across pretty well in between a lot of Fuka's constant one-liners. It's hard to say if this was the best performance in the dub, because there's definitely quite a lot of competition on that end. But this is definitely the funniest, and I definitely have to give my hats off to Faye for a job well done, because out of everyone here, she was clearly having the most fun recording this show, and it definitely made the performance a lot of fun. And so, like, and with that, it is time to say we're winding down and we're getting into our main duo. First up, we have Peter Hui, and I guess for the purposes of this episode, we will spoil Peter's actual identity in 3, 2, 1. In reality, Peter is secretly Len's favorite singer, Elsa Kanzaki. Which is actually a pretty obvious switch in hindsight, but yeah.
Yeah, like, I was like, by episode 2, I'm like, oh yeah, Pete Dow is like 100% the idol.
Pito is a mysterious gamer girl who Len befriends when she first starts playing Gungo Online. And after playing a few matches together, they agree to meet up in real life and Len can beat her in a duel. That's easier said than done, though, because in addition to being a skilled gamer, she's also kind of crazy and obsessed with the idea of death games where dying in a game means dying for real, and she threatens to kill herself if she loses the second squad jam. So Len vows to stop her by being the one to take her out. And while that's kind of complicated, anyway, playing Peter, we have one Allegra Clark. Allegra Clark has played such characters as Gin in Mugo Three Dogs, Sonya in Pokemon Twilight Wings, Jinyu in Fully Coin Progressive, and Boss and I had Somnium Files, just because I beat that game the other day. It is a lot of fun.
So, I gotta say, I don't think Len really accounted for getting a Yandere Gamer GF.
And she still got one faster than the Yandere simulator ever did.
Led got a Yandere gamer girlfriend faster than development of Yandere simulator.
Yandere simulator. I can't wait for us to get sued by him.
I don't even think we can.
Good luck with that.
Good luck with that. Anyways.
Don't worry, we got the ace legal team. We're good.
God damn it, I forgot. Callbacks.
Okay, Andrew, you want to go first?
Holy shit, Allegra Clark. Holy shit, is she talented. Like, it's been a while since we've talked Fate Apocrypha, which I believe was a lot of our first... That was basically a lot of our introductions to Allegra Clark as an actress. And God, that was a fucking insane introduction to her as an actress. Because she plays three very different sounding characters very convincingly. And yeah, as Pito Hui, she plays two really different sounding characters. One's the gruff, kind of like deep, sensual Yandere gamer GF. That is Pito Hui. And the other is the cute little adorable idol girl, Elsa Kanzaki. And fucking... Oh my god, she's nuts crazy. But like, a level of nuts crazy that you can tell, like, she's sometimes a psycho bitch. Sometimes she's like, lol, this is stupid, I'm having fun. Dude, this is lame. This is killing my boner. Like, she's got that level of energy and charisma to her. It's just like, man. Oh my god, Allegra is so stupid talented. She's so stupid talented as an actress. And she is bringing it all with Pito Hui as this crazy gamer girl who's obsessed with death. And also maybe is a psycho chick. Sorry, not maybe is a psycho chick.
She's my psycho girl.
Oh, boy.
My living nightmare.
Oh, God. But yeah, no, like, Allegra's a freaking treat. She's so great, and she bounces off of Len so good. Like, you can tell how giddy she is when she's around. The level of playful carnage she gets when she's getting really into the kill. Like, oh god, does she get really into it when she just, like, is readily, like, shoving the bead saber, the photon sword, nobody's gonna call it a photon sword, into the guy's face, and she's like, yes, that's me, don't you forget it. I'm like, oh god, it's so good, and she's singing German, and, like, she is so campy, she is so ridiculously, insanely, comically campy and cartoonishly evil. But she's also, like, the main character's love interest, basically. Which makes it even funnier. That it's basically, like, there's a level of romantic eroticism behind her saying, man, Pito, I'm gonna fucking kill you. It's like, yeah, baby. Hurt me more. Anyways, yeah, I'm basically done. Allegra Clark is a goddamn voice actress wizard. And she deserves your attention and respect if she isn't already.
Okay, Ruth, you want to go?
Yeah, going off of something Andrew said, I actually took 3 years of high school German. That is some actually really good singing in German. Like, holy crap. It's a scene that is basically window dressing to make sure that you are well aware that that Pito has gone way off a rocker, and it is scary effective.
What scene?
The German.
Where she's singing in German.
Oh yeah.
I love that she just sort of has the personality of just being absolutely bored with everything until she gets to kill. Mainly, the performance is just really good, especially at the very end. After the squad jam. After everything that went down, and So good. And then when they meet for the first time, and it's... Okay, so fun fact. I had just finished watching the show earlier today. And when it gets to the scene where it reveals that she's the pop idol... in case you don't know, Team Grimgar has its own designated chat channel on Twitter. I just go in there and I'm just like, motherfucker. Because one of her assistants basically does this really good impression of Pito to try and trick Karen into thinking she's Pito and not Elsa.
Yeah.
Elsa Kanzaki.
That's her. Elsa Kanzaki? Okay. That it's not her.
You can't fool a lesbian.
And I just love that scene to death. And Allegra Clark is so good in this. Like, holy crap. Every ounce of digitalized scenery in that show, she chews. And it is magnifique.
I'm still not sure, like... I still am trying to figure out if the show is trying to make me actually sympathize with her, or if they just know she's a psycho and they don't really care because Len's dating her.
I kind of wish that they had made her a psycho. Like, I guess I'll get into that in my thoughts.
Yeah, which I'm basically done, so.
Okay, cool. So yeah, no, Allegra Clark is fucking great in this, and if you sleep on Allegra Clark's acting, you're a fool. She is absolutely maniacal, crazy, psycho, unhinged, and I feel like a lot of actresses don't get to do that very often. I feel like a character like Pito is usually reserved for a male character, in other shows, and it's really nice to get to hear somebody play such a vile, nasty character like Pito, who is gleefully going around and killing people. And I think Allegra nails that. She's almost... There's like a childlike glee in her murder sprees. Where she is, in a weird sense, where everyone's like, please stop, this is just a game. To her, murdering and blowing off steam is a game. I mean, that's the whole reason that she's in there. I just wish that they had actually had a couple more episodes of this show to flesh out why the fuck Pito is like that, because they don't really give anything other than, oh, well, she missed her chance to be an SAO, that's it. It's like, but why is she mad that she missed her chance to be in a death game? Like, what's causing this? Because she's obviously got something fucking wrong, and like Len says, it's like, you need a therapist.
The idol industry happened, is my guess. And,
yeah, that's the thing, but they never go into that. They hint at it in, like, the background, like, oh, Elsa's taking off a tour, she's doing secret concerts, blah, blah, blah. But, like, they don't really go into it, like, how Len escapes into the game due to a body, like, dysphoria context. Pito, she's like, oh, I'm angry at life and I miss things, so now I want to play a death game, but they never really go into it. And good lord almighty, her relationship with M is creepy, and I just want to say that, like, anybody who's giving her a pass because she's a girl, that's not right. Like, she's a bad, abusive person. Like, I know the show wants me to sympathize with her. It really does, but, like, she's also creepy. It's like a whole thing. I was talking to my friend about SAO, and it's like, why are a lot of the SAO villains psychosexual? Like,
yeah,
almost all of them. Except for the first one.
The first one literally forgot why he was evil.
He put a bomb. Okay, wait, no. I can't say that he's not psychosexual. He put a bomb into his fiance's breast.
Okay, that's another thing entirely, but that's also...
God.
That's right. I forgot about that.
God, I love SAO. I hate it, but I love it.
Love it. God damn it, Alicization. But no, I think the thing that I like about this performance so much is that Allegra is just cutting loose. It's the same way that, like, obviously, like, Faye's Fuka is cutting loose. She's here having a great time. She's playing this awful woman character, and it's fantastic. I think that it's less that I'm critical at Allegra's performance, but maybe Pito's character writing, but I think she does a really good job, and it's hard to explain other than you kind of need to sit and watch it. Like, she's literally just, like, going nuts. Like, the part where she grabs a Peach-on, and she's like, wow, even your gun saved you! Like, even... It's so tongue-in-cheek at points. It's fantastic.
Okay. You're done?
Yeah, go.
Okay. So I'm always happy hearing Allegra Clark and new things. I've definitely been impressed with her range ever since she juggled being triple cast in Fate Apocrypha. And for the early parts of the show, she does a really good job of making Pito come off as kind of a woman of mystery, and she has this... And she has a sultriness to her voice that kind of gives the impression that Pito is probably an older woman in reality, and she definitely talks to Len about her life problems that way. And the way she kind of vouches out her in a casual duel definitely gives that impression. And Allegra handles a lot of that really well. But as we learn more and more about Pito from him, that impression kind of changes, and we get the impression that Pito is maybe a little more unhinged than it first appeared, and she definitely shows that when we get to the second squad jam. Allegra's Pito from that point on just kind of shifts from a more casual tone to being a lot more ruthless, and she definitely doesn't hesitate to do whatever it takes to win, whether it's gleefully slaughtering a bunch of teams coming after her, or backstabbing one that makes an alliance with her because, well, why the heck not? As ruthless as she is, though, you can definitely tell through Allegra's performance that she's having a lot of fun doing it. As the game goes on, you just kind of see her getting more and more excited by all the violence that's going on. And by the time she gets ready to have her duel with Len, she's practically a raging psycho, and I definitely really enjoy Allegra having it up with her insanity when Pito starts taking out dudes with a laser sword. A laser sword that is the one and only time Kirito gets referenced in the entire show. I'm pretty sure.
Kirito! Kirito.
Okay, if this was a real online game, somebody would be playing that obnoxiously over their headphones, and it would not sound good.
Pito's playing Duel of Fates the entire time.
So, okay, let's face it. If this was a real game and the laser sword was that OP, you'd see a lot more dudes with one.
Hacks OP.
Hacks.
Please nerf.
Also, be more of the guys would be asking them to send nudes.
By the way, I know this is, there's no really other good section to place this. I still hate the fact that this is a lot of these MMO games in the Sword Art canon have random characterization.
Oh yeah, that's so dumb.
Like,
yeah,
here's the thing: either you have create a character, or you do like a Fortnite Apex Legends, where it's like you select from various heroes and you can kind of customize them to how you like them.
Man, Kirito's gotten really good at his character selector, being kind to him.
Yeah. Wow, it looks like me, but with sometimes long hair. Wow, it looks like me, but... I don't know. Either way, how much money did Karen spend on video games, or did she do like free trials, like on a gaming streaming service?
It's not like free trials. I think it's just like transfer over like her character name, but because I'm pretty sure you can't do that in most games either. But I guess that's how VR works in this universe.
I don't get it. It's still silly to me, but
somewhere out there, Mother's Basement is writing a video.
Oh god.
The worst part is, for all intents and purposes, the way they play GTO in this game is probably the closest to an actual game any sort of art online thing has ever accomplished. Like GTO actually looks like it would almost be fun to play.
Yeah.
Also, I'd like to point out that her name is based off of a bird from New Guinea that's really pretty to look at, but it's like feathers are toxic or something like that.
Yep. Yeah, pretty sure.
Kind of fitting for an idol who doesn't like her job.
Ooh, yeah.
Getting back to the performance. By the time she's taking out the laser sword, Allegra definitely makes Pito sound like a woman child. So when Lana finally defeats her, and we meet the real Pito Hui, it's not surprising that he's probably a little long, that she's probably at least a little younger than she advertised. Like I said before, Laker's voice vocal range is wide enough that she was triple casted in the show. You would almost never be able to tell that. But even with that in mind, I was really surprised how high pitched and cutesy she was able to go for Pito as Elsa. And seeing her pull off that kind of vocal range was really surprising, since I'm so used to hearing her as sultry older women now. And it definitely kind of made it all the funnier when she just started floating with Karen out of the blue.
Elsa Kanzaki fucks.
Correct answer, Elsa Kanzaki pegs.
Yes. And especially just M's line afterward, it's like, be careful, she goes through men and women like paper.
What?
I'd like to point out that the teen girl squad totally sets her up for a date.
She made a lot of jokes, but there's like maybe one hetero character in the show, and it's probably just him.
No, Fuka's straight.
Pretty much.
No, Fuka's straight.
So for Elsa and Karen, the safety... What would the safety word be? Peachon?
Probably.
No, death gun. Death gun. The safety word is death gun.
I hate you now.
Autograph! Autograph!
Fuck.
So anyway, this was a really wild performance, and if you need a really good example of how great an actor Allegra Clark is, this is definitely a pretty good one.
Or you could play Fire Emblem Three Houses.
Oh, it's true.
Stan Dorothea.
Ah, Dorothea. So, you can say Dorothea, or you can say Samir if you're into that.
Yeah.
Friends don't let friends stan Raya.
That's a conversation for another night.
The church shady in a JRPG? I'd never.
Anyway, it's finally time to talk about our main heroine, Karen Gohiramaki, who also goes by the online handle Len. Karen is a shy college freshman who has a complex about being tall and wishes he could be short and cute. So she picks up VR games in order to live out that fantasy, but the only VR game that gives her that kind of avatar, because again, like, VR games in this universe are really stupid that way for some reason, is the online shooter Gale Online, where she takes up the name Len. While she initially isn't all that thrilled to play a online shooter, her short height, quick speed, and pink outfit giving her a surprising end to the game, and she quickly built a reputation as one of the most feared players.
The Pink Devil.
Yes, I just...
Because Monty Python's Killer Rabbit was trademarked.
Yes, I just specifically love the idea of, like, a pink outfit is OP in the desert, which is just amazing.
That's so funny. It's so stupid, but it's so funny.
Please let me go first.
So playing Len, we have Reba Burr. Reba Burr has played such characters as Athena in Saint Seiya of the Lost Canvas, Catalina Moldier in Violet Evergarden, Asuka Tanaka in Tiny Phonium, Our Promise, A Brand New Day, and mine in Ascendance of a Bookworm. And Megan, the floor is yours.
Yes. So, I would like to point out, before I go into talking about Reba's performance, that she literally takes out Pito by biting her fucking jugular.
That's how you know those two are into it. She goes for the throat.
Like, she literally goes, like, the Killer Rabbit in Monty Python after asking Fuka to cut her hands off.
Can we talk about
that? So that she can get out of her... to Fuka to cut her hands off, kicks her, and then headbutts her and bites out her jugular.
And it was in that moment Pito knew she was in love.
Like, holy shit, show. Like, man, you want to fucking solve War of the Underworld? Let Len in there for an hour. She'd be pegging Kazuta by the end of it.
Oh, God.
So, Reba...
She wouldn't want Kazuta. Was... Oh, she'd want everyone else.
Look, not everybody can be Yu-Gi-Oh.
Dayo.
If I'm correct, this was one of Reba's first leads, right?
Yep.
So, yeah, I want to compliment her for being able to get across Len as the cutesy high-pitched voice and the taller, soft-spoken Karen phenomenally. I could not believe that it was the same actress at first. I think it took me a little harder to get into her Len performance, because I think it was pushing her range a little too high at first. But then, obviously, as she got into the performance, it worked. Her Karen off the bat was perfect. She is absolutely a voice actress, a voice actor that you need to have your eyes on. And obviously, she has been getting it. She is the lead in Ascendance of a Bookworm. I think she's also the lead in Doro Hidoro.
We'll talk about later, but yes.
Yeah, we'll talk about later, but she is one of the leads, yes.
Yeah. She's in a lot of, like, big name stuff, and coming back to this, knowing this is kind of, like, the origin, is really cool. I absolutely loved her. I'm probably gonna like her in a lot of other stuff that I watch coming up, because she's in a lot of shows that I want to check out. She was phenomenal. She's up there as, like, a big reason why this dub works for me. And when she goes absolute... I think... Is she also her own gun?
Yeah, she's also her own gun.
Okay, the Peach-on shit is hysterical. And for some reason, you know what you know the only thing I can think of when it says Peach-on?
What?
Chi-John.
Oh, wow. Chi-John. That's a deep cut.
A deep cut into a giant marble cake. Like, I keep on thinking that it's like a fucking, it's like Cheetah the mascot would use Peach on the gun.
You're not wrong. For anybody confused, this is Last Week Tonight with John Oliver.
Just please look it up. We'll just link it in the description. But, her Peach on voice is great. I love when it's like, Len, look, what don't you see? And it's the sight line. And she's like to herself, I'll always protect you, Len. And you're just, I'm just like, did Len just drop some mushrooms mid-game? What the fuck?
Stress. No, I
like her, like, shonen battle psycho screams, too. So really good job, Reba.
Okay, Roots.
Yeah, I have to agree with a lot of what Megan just said. Reba as Len, it took me about an episode to get used to it, but after that, she was able to play the comedic tones very, very well. She could get serious when she needed to. Her as Karen was also really interesting. Len and Karen have two very distinct voices, and I was actually legitimately surprised to find out that they were both played by one actor. She is absolutely a riot when the scene calls for it. The stuff with Peach-on was, especially in the final fight, was just the best. Because it's always just this, oh, is my gun talking to me?
Peach-on, when she tries to name, what she's going to name her second one. Peach-on the second? Nah, you'll just be Peach-on.
You'll be Snowball 5. Actually, we'll just call you Snowball.
Don't!
I'm trying to think of a particular... Because there is one scene I really like, but it's more of a physical thing and not an acting. But it's during the first squad jam where she takes out the troop of professional soldiers by hiding in a suitcase.
Ah, that was amazing.
Oh, God, it's so good.
And just popping out like surprise motherfuckers and shooting them all down.
Oh, it's so good. And then they're like, ah, fuck this noise. She can't run like that, IRL. All right, we out.
I think the scenes I very much liked her interactions with Peach-on. Because she always kind of freaks out about it, and it's absolutely hilarious. And by the way, I don't know if this was mentioned yet. When Peach-on appears, it's like little hand-drawn eyes appear on the gun. So And it's just the funniest shit. I guess I would say I like her interactions with Ava. I like those a lot.
Oh, like when she first realizes it's her, and then they're like, yeah, I'm gonna beat you next time.
Yeah, there's that, and then there's, I want to say it was either during, it was at the very end of the first squad jam where she takes out the whole team, and then they have a bit of back and forth banter, or it was during the second one, and I can't remember. But they just always have these great interactions in game, and it's... And I love the fact that they just have a small and tall dynamic, both in and out of game, but the exact opposite.
It works really great.
I realized I forgot my favorite Len scene in the whole show.
What?
When she cuts the dude's dick off.
Oh, God!
Shit, that was what I wanted to bring up.
She literally slides under a dude and cuts his dong off, and it cuts back to the guys watching it, and a couple of them have their hands over their junk.
But they don't actually show it. Like, she's got the knife out, she's running underneath the guy, but it cuts to above the waist.
You
and he
see
just
his
does
face.
A, oh, face. Oh,
it's so funny.
Oh, God.
Thank God you're not wearing nerve.
Rape is great. I hope to.
I was going to say, thank God they're not wearing nerve gear.
So do you think that would count as a free vasectomy if they were?
I don't know if it works like that.
Oh, God.
But I love Reba Burr in this. I am ecstatic to think about the fact that I get to talk about her in other contexts probably later on.
My little gyoza.
She's a good actor. Thumbs up.
Yeah.
My little gyoza.
God damn.
Okay, right. Andrew.
So, Reba Burr is the dichotomy. I've complimented that. I love the dichotomy between, like, two different, like, vocal ranges. Len's is one of my favorite because you've got squeaky, cute, adorable little bunny girl of death. To very tall, suave, kind of introverted girl who's a lot prettier than she thinks she is. Who has a... I actually like the way you put that at earlier, Megan, where it's kind of like a bit of body dysphoria.
Yeah.
Which is like, yeah, kind of a little bit, but it's like, no, she's lovely the way she is. She's wonderful. You're great, Karen. But... God, Reba's just so fucking... talented the way she brings both sides of her out. I think the thing I like about her for a lot of the show is that she is so no-nonsense, even though she's adorable. Where you can tell, like, where she usually would be held up where it's like, ah, you're robbing somebody, why would you care? Just give me the shit. It's like, oh, she's no-nonsense, she don't care, she don't...
Shut up and give me the mask.
I love how nonchalant she says it with a high-pitched cutesy voice. It's like, I'm gonna kill you. Like, I'm gonna, like, basically just these very hardcore, like, Rambo-esque quotes. I swear I'm gonna kill you. Where it's like, I swear I'm gonna kill you. It's like, oh. It's,
get on your knees and pray to your god, bitch! I'm Michael Mouse!
Pick a god and pray, says Len.
Hold on. Pick a god and pray,
But yeah, no, like, Reba's just got this fluctuation in her tones of voice. And, like, she's adorable, she's sweet. And also, when she gets mad as Len, it's the funniest thing. When she talks about, when Pichon basically gets destroyed for the first time, she goes absolutely feral and is so good. And then also when she goes for the throat, it's so fucking funny. It's so goddamn amazing and feral and, like, just goddamn brutal and violent. I love every second of it. It's...
Every other dude in this series. Where's the threat behind the rabbit? It is the rabbit!
Oh, God. Like, seriously, Reba's just got a lot of versatility to her voice that she brings for both sides of this character. and it's just an absolute delight. It's one of the ones that makes the show for me, and she's doing an amazing job. Absolute thumbs up.
Okay. So Rebecca Burr, for me, is another one of the really underrated actresses in California, and it's kind of a shame because she does a lot of really fantastic work. And her Lent is definitely a really great example of that. When we meet Lent as Karen, Rayman makes her come off as kind of shy, lacking in confidence, but more in a way a real person would than like a cute boy anime girl or whatever. And Rayman's sort of voice simply makes her come off as a pretty believable 19 to 20 year old, which is a bit more of a rarity in anime than it probably should be. And as Karen kind of gets more involved in Yu-Gi-Oh, it kind of comes to terms with her insecurities about her height. Rayman may deserve to make her sound a little bit more relaxed with and comfortable with herself. While it's not like super noticeable, it's still pretty effective, and I like little touches like that. But good as her Karen is, it's simply Rayman's Lent. It really makes the performance a lot of fun. Compared to how like introverted and normal her Karen sounds, Rayman's Lent definitely does come off a little bit more as a cute, typical boy anime girl. But instead of walking around doing cute things, he's walking around blasting people with guns and definitely having a very merry time doing it. And when she first starts playing the game, she's just kind of thrown in head first. And Rayman gets a lot of her inexperience across really well as Len just kind of stumbles into confidence. And while we haven't talked about it, I really love like when Len first starts playing the game and you get the whole tutorial scene. That whole scene was amazing. And then like...
Oh yeah!
Oh god, I forgot about the tutorial scene with the fucking lady. I think that's Tamara Ryan is her actress, where she's just calling her a dung beetle.
I don't want to be a cockroach. I don't want to be a bug. Whatever year this is released, I don't want to be a bug. 2020, get stick bugged. You can't see it, but I'm making the motions.
Yes. But yeah, while she just kind of stumbles into confidence initially, as she plays more, she kind of gets a better feel for what she's doing, and her lens sounds a lot more confident. And she goes from being a total noob to kind of sounding like an old pro. And then we got a good kick out of just like one really random line where she mentions that she's gotten so used to looking for wire traps and doors in the game that she started doing it in real life. And this kind of funny thing, her turned into a hardcore gamer without realizing it. And especially when she explains that to Fuken, Fuken just sounds so proud, like, you've become such
my
a total
baby
nerd.
Girl, she's all grown up.
Gotta take out, she's all grown up and defending China.
Oh,
are you guys okay?
Okay, oh, I wasn't expecting a Mulan reference.
Now I'm imagining FaZe Girl as the dragon from Mulan. Goddamn.
Mushu?
Yes.
Does that make N cricky?
Oh.
Be a man.
You must be swift as a coursing bunny. Be a gamer with all the force of a pink typhoon.
Gamer
be
girl,
a
gamer with the force of a raging.
Face of a raging teabagger. Mysterious as the dark side of Kirito! Oh, God. Be a gamer girl.
God damn it. I missed Grimgar episodes. Fuck.
Be a... The next song on the list, what do we want? A harem worth fighting for! I want her paler than the moon, with eyes, with a gun that shoots real far. Fuck, I forgot the rest. Shit, I can do the actual song. I want her paler than the moon, with eyes that start like stars. Oh god, I don't know, I just remember, I've got a girl at home that's unlike any other. Yeah, the only girl that love him is his mother. Fuck, I haven't been to an anime con in so long, but I'm pretty sure if you started up a girl with fighting for half the people in the room would know everything.
Yes, and we should probably stop before the bounce actually, because that's the rest for real this time.
Michael Entertainment Mouse is going to come for your kneecap.
Look, remember, you gotta go, you gotta work, you gotta go for underneath the legs, and then you gotta get the bicep, and then you go for the throat.
Okay, and so anyway, getting back into the performance, I really liked how well Raven's performance kind of bounced off of the other three major characters, whether it's our whole student-mentor relationship with M, being kind of bad sisters with Fuka, or going totally nuts when he just decides to throw caution to the way to go all out and defeating Pito. He does a really great job just handling all those dynamics really well, and it helps him make the performance really well. Wow, did it a lot of fun. And again, gotta give Brave a brief thumbs up for also playing Peach-On. And since it's not like you can't tell she's talking to herself, since again, that's kind of the point, it was so really funny. And Peach-On was really adorable, and I'm glad that all who harmed her suffered accordingly. Like, except, like, literally every time Peach-On dies, it is preceded by Lin just killing whoever is responsible.
Oh, it's blood! It's bloody murder. And all
it's great.
All that bloody murder makes her Yandere gamer girlfriend all the more attracted to her.
Yeah. Yeah, I definitely really adored this performance, and I'm glad Raven's gotten at least a few more lead roles since then, since he really deserves it, and she's definitely very good at what she does. And with that, we are good to move on to final thoughts.
I'll make mine quick. This was a lot of fun to watch. As somebody who is not super keen on the Sword Art Online as a franchise, I do think this has a lot of the same flaws as its parent series. But as a dub, it is just as enjoyable as the dubs for SAO, SAO GGO, SAO Alicization. Because fuck us all, there's so many seasons of it.
Ordinal Scale and War of the Ordinal Scale
World. Shut up, that's just Alicization Part 2, Electric Boogaloo.
Ugh, you're right.
This was a lot of fun. I really like a lot of the casting in this. This is, I think, a dub that I'd actually point to for a lot of people who are like, oh, all anime dubs use the same, like, five people. Because I'm gonna say that like the greater anime fan base or people who are really casual about dubs probably don't know who Reima Burr or Allegra Clark are, or Faye Mata, even though okay, Faye and Allegra maybe more nowadays because they are in Fire Emblem Three Houses, which now officially makes them actually relevant to some people. We can talk about that later.
We knew them before they were popular gamer girls.
I'm kidding. I'm not gonna be a gatekeeper about it.
I know, I'm only kidding.
Remember,
gatekeeper is Kyle McCarley!
Yes, the only good gatekeeper is Kyle McCarley.
Why can't I date the gatekeeper, NC?
Let us fuck the gatekeeper.
Whoa. I politely take him out to a nice dinner. I'm too busy fucking to do. Anyway.
Okay, fair enough.
Lord have mercy, Andrew.
Now just remind that I've seen at least one meme where it's like the whole confession scene at the end of Fire Emblem Three Houses, but instead of one of the girls, it's just like Bailiff saying, saying to the gatekeeper, I love you more than all 39 of those other students.
Which,
Anyway, great. This is a really fun dub to listen to. I definitely recommend it for anybody who's looking for like a good way to veg out on some popcorn fuel for a couple hours. So, a lot of fun.
Roots.
Yeah. So, the mainline Sword Art Online series has a bit of a reputation, depending on who you ask. Glad to say this is actually an interesting thing to suggest because you really don't need to know anything from the mainline Sword Art Online series in order to enjoy it. It is completely 100% standalone, and a lot of the things that would that detract people's opinions of Sword Art Online, they are not apparent here.
If there's one thing that GGO has taught me that main Sword Art series needs more of, it's violent gamer lesbians.
If you need an example of detraction of SAO, of detractions of SAO praising this show, let's not forget that one of the most vocal detractors of SAO Mother's Basement actually went on record saying, like, yeah, this show is totally fine.
It's fun. I'll also argue, I don't think it's 100% not needing. I'd say at least 97%.
You should have a vague recollection. You should have, like, if you've seen, like, one or two episodes of Sword Art, you're fine.
I'd say 97%.
If you know how the nerve gear works, and if you know Kirito is always overpowered,
we also just
good.
Occasionally drop the fact that, oh yeah, the idol girl is using the nerve gear because that's what she's into, and we just don't go anywhere with that.
Like I said, I kind of brought it up that if this was a couple of episodes longer, we could have gone into that, but nope. Mm. 12 episodes it is.
That's what it is.
But the show is an absolute blast. The dub is a delight. I actually... Okay. Making sure that I am free of all sources of potential lightning. It is a Sword Art Online show that I would highly recommend.
Mm, okay.
Are you afraid that God's gonna smite you down? I'll fight God. I've played enough JRPGs.
Attack and dethrone God.
We're gonna attack and dethrone God.
Attack and dethrone God, that dick is mine.
Attack and dethrone God, that dick is mine.
Okay, but now I'm imagining instead of what do we get able to have profits, what do we get into Kirito?
Kirito! Kirito! Hardy's gonna beat the shit out of me for that.
God bless. Alright.
Imagine Cloud and Tifa banging in Kirito and Asuna's outfits.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure Hardy's on you. I'm pretty sure Hardy's.
Okay, we're gonna have you stop right there. For your own health and safety.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure Hardy's on his way to your location right now.
I'm just saying, it could be better if Aerith is taking herself to Handytown as dressed as Aerith. Aerith dressed as Shion.
The only thing Aerith needs is me, myself, and I.
And a chair.
A chair. No, a
and
table.
A steel
a
chair.
No, we're
and a steel chair.
No, a table coon. Kind of like I'll go. Let's go. Let's go.
No. This is Sword Art Online, not Code Geass.
You're joking, but I'm pretty sure there is at least one scene in the Final Fantasy remake where she does in fact beat up someone with a chair.
Oh God.
Yeah, that's why I said a chair. Anyway, I'm sorry. Reeds, go back ahead.
I was actually
okay.
Done.
Okay. I'm sorry I stole your thunder.
Alright, so. I have seen this dub before. I watched it once. I watched it at the gym once, back when gyms were a thing. So. This is a fun show. It's a very fun, chills, dumb show. It's not. It's got some flaws that the main SAO series has, but what it also inherits is a kind of fun universe that they can play around with the video game universe for and have some fun with it, as well as the really strong, exceptional dub cast and crew and direction from one Alex Von David, who, like I said, we joke about SAO. It's very clearly a series he's super passionate for and loves working on, and you can very much tell that in SAO GGO, that's kind of continues to be the case. This is a fun cast and crew of characters, and it's a fun side story to play with. You've got some really good, insane vocal registers on display for several of the characters, especially Reba, Allegra, Faye, and Rei in particular, as well as the gamer girls. There's a lot of, like, cool vocal stuff. The dialogue is snappy. I forgot to bring up one of my favorite lines of dialogue in the show, because there's no place to put it, and it's basically, bitch move using the dead guy like a shield, and it's like, it's not against the rules, don't call her a bitch, you dick. Hello.
God bless.
I love that line. This is a fun show, and it's a pretty fun dub. It's not without its flaws, but you know what? I had fun watching it, and it's... Sword Art can be kind of fun when it's dumb, and for the most part, this is pretty dumb fun, and I had a good time with it. #YanderegamerGF.
Yeah.
Hashtag before Yandere simulator.
As for me, I had a lot of fun with this show. I am admittedly not a big Sword Art Online person, and by not a big Sword Art Online person, I initially dropped the show around episode 14, which remains like one of the single most frustrating viewing experiences I've ever had watching anything. But coming off of that, I actually enjoyed this show a lot more than I was expecting to. It's simply not without its flaws, and there are some parts of it that are kind of weird, but I definitely had a much easier time kind of turning my brain off to it, and once I did that, it was definitely a lot of fun to watch. And while the character dynamics were a lot of fun, and I got a lot of kicks out of a lot of their interactions. And the dub definitely helped with that. Alex Von Damon's direction here was really great. I really dug how punchy the script was. And really, all the actors here sounded like they were having a lot of fun recording the show, and that just really helped add to the whole experience. So yeah, the dub here is really great. The show is pretty fun, and if you're not a really big Sword Art Online person, maybe give this show a shot. It might not totally change your opinion on the franchise, but it is definitely at least decent popcorn entertainment, so yeah, it was a pretty good time.
And happy birthday, Jet. This was a fun time.
Happy birthday.
This was a fun time getting the crew back together to talk about the crazy gamer girls.
Yeah, this was a pretty good time.
I just have a suggestion for you guys, though.
Mm-hmm.
Sword Art Online Christmas special!
We shall wait and see what the year holds, but... we'll see.
We'll see. So we're basically done for tonight, but if you want to see anything... If you want to see anything we do normally, we are the Dub Talk Podcast. You can type in addition to our YouTube channel here. You can find us on Twitter, Instagram, Tumblr is dead. And if you would like to support anything we do, we have a Ko-fi where you can do a one-time donation to help us out. And of course, we have a Patreon where you can donate to us monthly. And before we finish tonight, I'd like to give a shout-out to some of our patrons. We have our $5 tier patrons, B. Morris, Crimson Akinda, Michelle Travis, Miraculous Corzo, Nika Robin, What With Yowie Hands, and Victor Meyer Boda. For our $10 tier patrons, Anthony Simpson, Kari Lesikow, Jacob Wilson, J2, a.k.a. Jared, W and Marissa Lenti. Thanks again, guys. You're all really awesome. We appreciate your support.
Love your faces. You're all wonderful, beautiful people.
Thank you for the money.
Jeez, you didn't have to say it like that, Megan.
Thank you for the support.
Thank you, money. Thank you for continuing to be our sugar daddies and mommies.
We're not extortionists, guys. It'd be like that.
Oh, Nora Standpipe. How I love her! Father's mother.
God!
No, but really, if it wasn't for our Patreons, we would not be able to afford our RSS feed.
If you're tired of using YouTube, which...
Tube.
Man, trying to...
Frankly, who is
who
it?
Who isn't? You can listen to us on, thanks to our RSS feed, on Apple Podcasts or Spotify. You can take us on the go, and you can listen to us in your ear. This is us talking in your ear.
Andrew, get the fuck back.
This is our ASMR now in your...
Andrew, no, you stop that.
Andrew,
stop.
No.
Andrew, no.
Don't make me get the spray bottle. All
right. So is there anything you guys would like to plug?
Yeah, you can follow me at QueenEra2 on Twitter. I shitpost and talk about my cat.
Roots of Justice on the Twitter.com at Roots of Justice. Reviews coming at some point.
My name is Andrew, aka Classy Spartan. You can find me on Twitter at MangaMan9000. Another thing I do is I am a co-host on Surreal Resolutions Podcast ONA, which talks about anime industry news and the likes, alongside fellow Dub Talk co-host Jet. Hey, buddy, how you doing, Val?
I am doing good. And as for me, you can find me on Twitter at Divine Digger, where I will usually be talking about cartoons, animation, anime, like, whatever. You can also sometimes find me on my blog, Animes in Infinity, where I will occasionally write things if I feel like it. And you can, and as just mentioned, you can also find me on another podcast, O&A, where I'll usually be talking about anime news alongside fellow Dumb Talk host Andrew.
Hi. That's me.
And with that, we're basically done here for tonight, so thanks again for joining me, guys.
I got a question for you guys.
What's that?
I got a question for you guys before we go.
What's that?
Do y'all want some Portuguese breakfast?
Otaku.
Okay, you want to talk about restraint? We've gone almost 2.5 hours without referencing the SAO bloopers once until now? Or even...
That's a lie!
Okay, Andrew, you know that's just going to be the entirety of the eventual actual SAO episode.
Touche. The other... Here's the actual other restraint. We have gone almost 2.5 hours without making a single Karen joke. That's restraint. Shit.
Well, you know there's always time for the disclaimer.
Yes, okay, look, there's only one Karen in this show, and she's actually very good.
She's a very... Oh, okay. Just because we're gonna... This is a callback to another episode, and just because we've gone this far without me being dunked in a Barris. I would take a ride in her minivan! Good night, everybody!
Okay, you know what? You're gonna pass for that because I would actually agree with you.
Yeah!
And with that, this 2.5 hour journey is over. Feel free releasing it. Good night, Otaku On.
Team Grimgar, signing out.